Now in its 10th year, this is GabNet. Talk like you've never heard it before.
Hey, everybody. Yes, live from Harlem in New York City. Yeah, it is I, Alex, and this is The Ramble, and we'll be here until midnight tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, here we go, spending another 25 goddamn minutes with Larry goddamn Brown.
It's going to be goddamn funny.
Yeah, let's change it from bubbles to goddamn.
What was it John Wayne did? Re-goddamn ridiculous or something.
Re-goddamn ridiculous. Oh, boy. So how do I sound, by the way? Do I sound better than I usually sound?
You sound like you always do. Your voice sounds the same as it did 40 years ago.
Yeah, but I just bought a $300 microphone, and I just want to know, does it sound different?
Not to me.
Oh, okay. Well, I was listening to a playback, and it sounds better. Sounds better.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
But well, anyway. I got a bad ear, so.
Yeah, well, it's a bad ear. I mean, do you literally have a bad ear, or?
Yeah, I've got raging tinnitus.
Oh, really?
Yeah, this is the typical Does it hurt? Anything they can do for that? Nope.
Oh, well, I've got neuropathy, right? Old people get neuropathy. People with diabetes get neuropathy. A lot of people get neuropathy. Neuropathy is very common. It's where you lose really all the nerves in your feet and legs. They just don't. And then they stop transmitting to your brain, and so you don't have a sense of balance.
All right? Oh, wow.
Okay. So I have neuropathy. And I live with it, okay? But I go to this nerve guy, whatever. And he tells me, I've got neuropathy. All right, fine. What do we do about it? Well, there's very little you can do about it. Well, wait a minute. This is medical science.
I know.
A lot of people have neuropathy. Don't you have something? And no, not really. There are a couple of operations we do that may help, but that's it. And I'm going, this is ridiculous, you know.
It's like they're not even trying.
Yeah, I mean, come on. You go out, you solve the mystery of COVID in a week and a half, and you can't come up with some kind of thing to clear up my neuropathy or at least to help it or to compensate for it or whatever. No, we don't have anything like that. Okay, well, do you have anything? Yeah, well, we got a pill, Lyrica. Pregabalin, it's called generically. And so I do pregabalin. And the pregabalin makes me forget stuff. You know? Like I'm taking a high, the last couple of days I've been taking a really high dose and I'm feeling a lot better, but I also remember a lot less. Okay? And I'm wobbly and I bump into walls and whatever, but at least the neuropathy is better. But the drug is worse than the disease. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, there's always a trade-off.
Yeah, I mean, the method of cure in a lot of things is worse than the... I just think of the way they cure a lot of things today, and it's kind of like voodoo science. That make sense to you?
Oh, yeah.
You know?
Not a fan of big pharma.
Yeah. Like, well, I've got this. What do I do for it? Here, take a drug. What? I have to take a drug? Why? Well, because you have to take a drug for this. And it's the only thing that'll fix it. Okay, well, what are the side effects of the drug? Well, you might feel a little lightheaded and disoriented and forget stuff. Oh, great. Those are the side effects. Do you have anything that doesn't have side effects? No. You know, and when as you get older, here's the thing that happens when you get older. They start worrying about everything you've got, right? So if I go to get my yearly test with a doctor and my blood panel is off, I get sent to a oncologist, hematologist to find out if it's cancer. Whoa, you know. But if I had had the same blood work done and it came out the way it did when I was 50, it wouldn't do anything about it. So, like, currently I'm going through this thing where my doctor sends me a note with a prescription kind of thing. Says, go in and get a new CT scan for your nodules in your lung. Now, I have these two little nodules in my lung, one of which I've had for 8 years. Now, anytime you have a nodule that's 8 years old, they don't do anything about it. They say that's benign. Doesn't change size in eight years. There was a newer one that appeared about 2 years ago, the first time I got any kind of a scan of my lungs, since the one that was before, where it was like 8 years ago. And it came out, and it's called a prefissural node. And I look it up, and it says, oh, yeah, these things can grow in size, but they're never considered malignant. So now I get this thing from my doctor to go get another scan, like a year later after the last one. And I'm going, why? I mean, at the bottom of the last report, it said, suggestions, retest if when you want to, you know, occasionally. Well, it just makes no sense to me. If the two I've got aren't threatening at all, why even do it again? Well, because, you know, look how old I am, you know. Oh, it might have gotten worse. You might have lung cancer. No, you know, it's enough that I'm going to a doctor for leukemia, okay? And it's a kind of leukemia that is manageable, okay? So I'm not worried about that, but I have to go in every 3 months for a test to make sure that everything's fine, right? And that's okay by me. Keep me alive that way. But don't make me go in and get one more test, one more CT scan, just because you think, well, we got to make sure it hasn't gotten larger. Well, what are the chances it got larger? Well, there isn't any chance it got larger, but we want to make sure it didn't. You know, it's just ridiculous. That's what medicine is today. It's imprecise.
You know? Yes, and that's why they drive up the cost of health care with all this shit.
Oh, yeah.
Endless testing.
I go get a CT scan. That's $500. The government's got to pay out. You know? CT, anything in radiology is not cheap. You know? But I've had lots of tests and so on to see how I am. And I come out, okay for the most part, but, you know, I came out with this. My doctor said, hey, your blood panel's off. Go to a hematologist, oncologist. So I went to him, and he came out and said, oh, you've got CLL, which is chronic lymphocytic leukemia, which is, they say, the most common leukemia among old people, and it's really not very much a problem, you know. So as long as you don't have any symptoms, we don't do anything. I go, okay, that's fine. You say you don't do anything. They said, we'll just wait and see, and if you don't have any symptoms, we'll just keep an eye on you. And that's fine with me.
I like that.
You know, I mean, also, I got to tell you, it has to do with the doctor, too. The doctor I have for the leukemia is great. I mean, you walk out of his office and you feel, hey, I feel better about my condition, you know, because he gave me confidence in it. Well, that's what a doctor should do. That's the job of a doctor.
Very important, yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, do you have any, you don't have any life-threatening things yet, do you?
Not that I know of, no.
Not that you know of, but you will get them. I mean, you know, I had prostate cancer. And what it was very minor prostate cancer. It was showed up as in one of my lobes, and it was just very very light, not heavy enough, but heavy enough that they had to operate on the prostate by doing the seeds and doing radiation and so on, just to make sure that it didn't get worse. Okay. So they did all of that. And so now every time I do something on the report, it says, your subject had cancer. And I'm going, why is that necessary? You know, it wasn't a deadly form of prostate cancer. Why'd you put that down? And now probably you'll say had cancer and leukemia. So now they're going to want to test me all the time for everything, you know.
Oh, yeah.
And the fact is that neither of these things are life-threatening. So, at least so far, it's not life-threatening.
How did you find out you had the prostate cancer?
Well, I go in every year. My prostate, my PSA level was a little on the high side, and I had this horrible doctor. I mean, his office looked like a illegal abortion clinic. You know, and
coat hangers,
and he was, you know, he wanted to do finally a biopsy on me, and I went, screw this. So I went and had somebody, my general practitioner, suggested a guy to me, and I went to see him. And I never liked a urologist. Urology is a form of medicine that is complete with nothing but a bunch of just weird people doing it, you know. And this guy wasn't weird at all, and he was very helpful, and he didn't rush it, and he took a test. He said, well, it looks a little suspicious. Well, I'll send you over to an oncologist. And the oncologist looked at it, and he said, okay, we need to operate on it. We'll do radiology, and then we'll do the seeds. And he said, they should take care of it. I looked at him. I said, am I going to die of this? And he looked at me, and he went, no. You know, like, so silly boy, you know, it's not like you're in danger. And to this day, knock on wood, almost 5 years later, the high PSA has not returned. So I'm fine. And that doctor, that urologist, I love him because he watched out for me, you know. And I knew he wasn't going to do anything that wasn't necessary, entirely necessary. He doesn't even like to do biopsies if he doesn't have to. But then he did it, and it was totally painless, which it shouldn't be. So, you know, I really like my urologist.
I thought that was painful, those things. Yeah,
some people say it's been painful to them. To me, it just sounded like he was using a staple gun, you know, and that was it. I didn't feel anything. So,
did they give you anything for that?
No. No, he said, we could put you out, but it's so fast, and you probably won't feel anything, because they shove some liquid up there to numb the whole area and everything, you know. So, I just trusted him, and I trust him to this day. It's the one time I look forward to a doctor who's going to do tests on me. And every year he draws the blood, and every year he writes me a note the next day, congratulations. You're fine, you know. And
that sounds like a good doctor.
A very good doctor, you know. And the doctor I've got, the leukemia guy, is terrific. I love him. He's really, you know, he's just, I don't care if they're lousy doctors. Just have a nice bedside manner, okay? You know, these guys happen to be pretty good. In fact, the guy who did the seeds on me is the guy who did the prostate seeds on what's his name? The America's mayor, Rudy Giuliani.
Mm.
Remember he had, remember when he had prostate cancer and they put seeds in?
Well, this pretty common.
This was the guy who did it. Kept Rudy Giuliani alive. That's the one thing I will never forgive him for. But otherwise, he's a pretty good doctor. But you don't.
Have you ever had a colonoscopy? I've never had that, and that just sounds like. Well, it's not the colonoscopy; it's the preparation for it.
Well, I do a prep. I do a prep. A lot of people don't do, and it's a small bottle of stuff. I can't remember the name of it right now. If I went to the store, or maybe I may have some in my closet. It's just very simple. You just drink it. once, and then you poop your brains out. But they make you, a lot of other people, make you go get this thing where there's like a gallon of the stuff you got to drink.
Yeah.
Over a period of time. And it doesn't work as well as the other stuff, you know? Citric something or another. But the prep is shitty, okay? You drink this stuff, and then it's kind of like you evacuate everything that's in your bowels, in your intestines. And then you took
all take, night, right?
Yeah. After about the fifth time you're on the toilet, okay, it's pretty much through, okay? It starts coming out clear, all right? And then the next morning, you got to do a little bit more before you go to see him, and you have to poop your brains out once or so. And then you go to the doctor, and he sticks a needle in your arm, puts you out, okay? And you wake up, you feel like, you know, 25 minutes has been edited out of your life. And you wake up, and the doctor's there going, okay, we're through, you know? So in that respect, it's simple. The prep is just, you know, is not fun. It's not harmful.
They want me to do that, and I'm not going to do it. So.
Well, I would do it. You know, I don't do it anymore because my doctor said at your age we don't do them. You know, because they figure if I get a colon cancer, I'm not going to get it before I'm dead. All right, it's very slow growing. If you go tomorrow and they find a bunch of polyps and they cut them out and they all come back non-cancerous, some of them they say are precancerous, you know, but whatever. And then they come back with that. They just tell you to come back in a couple of years, you know, no big deal. But it's like, you know, I just feel like I'm on this, in this doctor mill, you know, where it just goes on and on and on. And I'm always fearful of going to my GP every year to get the blood test because he's going to find something else about me that needs to be done. And at my age, everything needs to be done, okay? So just pray you don't live to be as old as I am, okay? Yeah. I told you about Christy, didn't I?
I saw that. I heard about it. Yeah, oh. I wanted to bring that up at the beginning, but I was just shocked by that.
Yeah, she's been sick for about 7 years. Okay.
I did not know that.
Yeah.
I had a gig in Modesto. I think she lived out in Modesto when it was like 15 years ago or so, and she came out to see me. And she's such a beautiful, nice woman.
Everybody, the first word that comes out of everybody's mouth about her was beautiful.
Yeah,
I mean,
she was.
Stunningly beautiful. Okay.
Yeah.
And
a personality to match, which is rare.
Very nice person. Very nice person. And she worked with me at the Quake, and then she worked for a short time, and then she worked with me at Live 105. And at a certain point, I had to get rid of her as a producer because she was becoming too protective of the show, let me say. You know, I was doing a show one day, and she came in the middle of it during a break and started yelling at me. You shouldn't have done that. You should have done this. And, hey, why'd you do that, you know?
Really?
Yeah, and I just said, I can't put up with this. So we parted ways. But then I went and did the thing for Play TV, and I got a call from her, and she said, I left my husband, and I'm looking for a job, and if you know anybody that has a job, please help me, you know, find a job. And I said, well, I might have one for you. And I hired her on a play. And you remember, she ran that office and produced the show, and she was pretty terrific, you know.
Yeah.
And it was a pleasure to work with her at that point. She had suddenly grown up a little bit and knew how to comport herself. And then Play TV was over, I brought her over to CNET Radio, and she worked with me there for about a year. So, you know, she was very close to me over the years, and I just adored her. I just thought she was the best.
I didn't know she'd been sick that long. God.
Yeah, she had breast cancer, and they did something about it. I might say she had lovely breasts, you know. So, sad.
How old was she?
She was. I think she had approached. She was in her 50s by that time.
God.
You know, it somehow it went away, of course, you know, and then it came back. It had gone somewhere else, and I guess she'd just been fighting cancer for the last 7 years. So it hit her in her mid-50s, you know, because she died at 61. So, you know, but it was sad to see her go. And I thought I'd told you, but I guess I didn't.
No.
The last time we talked, I wasn't in possession of this information. But you knew her pretty well. I mean,
yeah, she was just a, you know, like a super nice person. Damn.
Yeah.
Nobody, so much for the karma theory.
Well, nobody. Like only the good die young. Well, wait a minute, that is true. It is true in her case. You know, she should have had at least 10 more years. But
yeah. Oh, boy.
Yeah. Well, you know, if you live long enough, Larry, like I am, little advice to you. You're what, 72 now?
Yes, I will be in September.
Yeah. 72.
Why can't they come up with a cure for cancer? How long is this going to take?
Well, there's no one cancer. That's the thing I've
found. There's so many.
Cancer is an umbrella term for growths which invade the body and, you know, you have to take care of. Some of them are very simple. Sometimes, like, I've heard the word cancer twice or something like cancer. Cancer once and leukemia another time. And in both cases, I had completely manageable cancers. So people, they say, these are things that I'm going to die with but not from. Okay. So I'm still wondering. I wake up every morning and go, what's going to get me? You know, and one day I will find out what's going to get me. I have no idea.
But, just as you get older, you think more and more about it.
Do you go to a doctor once a year for a checkup?
No, they always ask me to come in, and I never do it.
You see, I mean, at your age, it might be good to do it. It's just as a preventative thing, because a lot of times they can catch stuff before it's a problem, you know. I mean, if I didn't go to the urologist with this prostate cancer, if I didn't go to urologist every year, I wouldn't have known about this cancer, which was not very bad. You know, it wasn't very invasive, especially at my age. Most men, if you live to be my age, will get cancer, prostate cancer, and but you won't die of it at that age, you know. So when guys get it at 50, that I worry about it for them. But, you know, but no, you should go get a PSA test just to make sure your prostate's in good shape. And it probably is, you know, though you don't know, you haven't had to use it for a long time.
Well, I think my last blood test last year, there was no PSA test score. And I called the doctor and she goes, we stopped doing that at age 70.
Really? I heard it was... Well, yeah, you're right. You're stopping doing them at age 70. Yeah.
I think she said, well, if you get a high score, that means they're going to start doing a lot of invasive tests, and they think it's usually doesn't kill you anyway.
Yeah, but it's still You know, it's not supposed to be... They've argued for years that the PSA test didn't mean much, you know, that they were unreliable. But some people feel that they are an indicator of something if you have it, and that's a problem in and of itself. But I wish you good health.
I wish you.
But you're at that age where, you know, you get in the doctor mill. Oh, well, I think you better go see this guy for this, and you better go see that guy for this, and this guy for that, and then you've got... Like Marjorie, she has her calendar filled every week with doctor's appointments. She has a doctor for every part of her body. You know, so it's amazing.
Well, she's healthy.
She is. I think she's healthy. She thinks she's not healthy. You know, she got back problems and things like that, but she hasn't come down with cancer like I have twice. I use it as an excuse not to take out the garbage. Take out the garbage. No, I'm sorry. Yeah. I can't. I got cancer. You know, I've got cancer. I think you better take it out. Anyway, hey, listen, we're running out of time, and this is always a pleasure. And I don't know what number this is, but we did, what did we say, 230 at one point?
It's getting close to 250, yeah.
You're getting close to 250. Boy, we should hold like a big party or something when when we get to 250. But anyway, Larry Bubbles Brown, who meets us, joins us, has something to do with us once a week. Thank you very much, Larry.
See you next
again,
week.
Greatly appreciated. Bye.
Okay. Bye bye.
Now in its 10th year, this is GabNet. Talk like you've never heard it before.
Yes, and welcome back. Okay, let me turn some things down here bring things down so I don't have them too loud. Okay. All right. I still have trouble with this new mixer, which is a great mixer. I don't want to give it a bad time, but it does have problems. And I don't hear things the same way that I heard them before. And I have to get everything just set just right. There's a thing here that I had to set called a noise gate. And what it does is, you know, we have noise in this room. We have an air conditioner back here, and, you know, there's noise from outside and so on and so forth. So what the noise gate does is it opens up when I'm talking. Okay. So maybe you hear a little bit of noise from the air conditioner. And then if I don't say anything, all of a sudden, it cuts the sound out. So, you know, I've been trying to set that perfectly for a week now, 2 weeks. But I think I finally have it set. Okay, so everything's okay. And but the things don't sound the same like they should in my earphones. And I have a big headset I could wear here where it really sounds terrific. But I just, you know, I can't do that. I just can't do that. So... because I don't like him. Well, look at this. Look at this. Do you want to see this on me for a whole show? You know, all right, like that. Okay. Hello. How are you? Don't I look good? Oh, fuck that. It's just they're big and they're clunky, but they sound great. They just sound great. Anyway, why don't I go to we have two people waiting. First of all, Charlie Wallace is waiting, and also Roberta, who has been a new caller to the show. This is her third night in a row. She's getting addicted to this whole thing. Let's wait and see if Roberta comes up here. There we have. Let me see. Don't trip. What does it say?
Oh, I don't trip. I do random gravity checks.
Oh, I see. Okay. Are you a tripper?
Yes. Oh. I have the same neuropathy you have. So
yeah.
Yes, I
do. Oh, okay. So, I mean, but do you have trouble walking long distances?
No.
No?
I just trip a lot. So.
I think part of my problem is that I don't have, where's Roberta? Asked to unmute. Oh, there she is. Okay,
she is.
Finally. Yeah. All right. No, but I don't. My feet. My legs are tired now. I don't think I've done enough exercise lately, and I have to do more exercise. And the doctor The doctor wants me to go to physical therapy. And here's the problem with physical therapy. You go there for an hour. They do an hour's worth of whatever they're going to do, okay? Now, that should be enough to make you feel better, right? But it isn't. They send you home and say, now do these exercises at home. Well, wait a minute. If I wanted to do all this stuff at home, I would just ask you for a list of things to do, and then I'd never see you again. But my doctor wants me to come back twice a week for 12 weeks. Why don't you just tell me what I'm supposed to do at home, and we'll just call it homework, and I'll do it, okay?
Well, he doesn't get paid for what you do at home.
Oh, really?
No, I mean, you go in to see him for the initial visit to get the list.
Yeah.
And he gets paid for that. But once you go home and exercise on your own, he gets no money. That's why he wants to see you every week or two times a week or whatever.
I was wondering tonight if I couldn't get somebody to do physical therapy on me that just comes out to the house.
Sometimes.
Are there physical therapy people who come out to the house?
Yeah.
I think I might do that. I'm too late. I don't want to walk so much that I'm too lazy to leave the house for my physical therapy.
You know. Yeah.
But did you go to physical therapy?
Yes, I did. When I got my toes taken off, I had to have.
As we all know, Charlie is toe impaired. Can we call it that?
Yes.
Yeah. They took what? Six toes?
Six toes.
Yeah. So we refer to him like a gangster. He's Charlie Four Toes. you want to say something, Roberta?
No, I was just going, ow.
It didn't hurt because I had neuropathy. I don't feel pain in my feet. So.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, I feel, excuse me, I feel some pain in my feet, okay? So that's not a problem. I do feel pain in my feet.
That's why I don't take the pregabalin anymore is because my nerves are completely dead. I don't have feel anything.
Really? Yep. Oh, my God. Well, no, mine aren't that dead. In fact, sometimes I'll stub my toe and it will hurt. So, you know.
It's been 20 years since I hurt my toe stubbing it.
So you really wish your toes would hurt, I guess.
Yeah.
Huh? Yeah. Yeah. Well, anyway, so how's my mic sound tonight? Good?
Sounds great.
Sounds great? Okay. Because I can't tell, through these ears. Unless I wear the big clunky earphones, then I can tell. So, anyway, let me see. Where is everybody? There's nobody calling tonight.
What's happening?
Yeah,
it's Friday. Nobody's got to go work tomorrow. They should be here.
Yeah, yeah, they should be here. Well, Josh is working, so that I know. Yeah, but last night we had a lot of people here, and it was a Thursday, which is usually the day that nobody calls. So I can't. Come on, folks, give us a call. Not that these two people aren't top notch, and I could probably do the whole hour with them. Okay. All right, here comes.
You could probably do the whole hour with Roberta.
Yeah.
Well, actually, we probably could do a whole hour because for some reason, Alex doesn't remember me. So we'll.
Well, wait a minute. Now, you see, I mean, I don't feel upset. There are a lot of people.
I'm not upset. I'm amused. I am quite amused.
There is a guy who called this program for a long time. His name was Phil Meyer. And he claimed that we did nothing but hang out all the time back in San Francisco. And to this day, I don't remember him. So don't feel bad about that, because this guy was probably part of my life, every day of my life, and I don't remember him. So, you know.
Well, I'm the one who named the Quake. Do you remember? I'm the one that came up with the call letters. I was working for KSFX ABC. We tested the Quake call letters, and I mentioned that to you. Yeah.
Well, this was a station that I was with before Live 105 called The Quake. Mm-hmm. And it's funny that we named it The Quake because there had always been a feeling that, oh, hey, San Francisco, The Quake, what a great name for a radio station. But then they did some studies, and they found that it had a negative connotation. Mm-hmm. And that if you named it The Quake, people wouldn't be happy with that.
Yep.
You know, and I don't understand it but we used it and it worked right. Fine. People loved it, you know.
It worked, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You may remember me. You used to get free movie tickets.
Yeah.
And You invited me out to the movies.
Oh, did I really? Well, how nice of me.
He doesn't remember. I love it.
Was I decent? Was I good?
You were a gentleman.
Okay. All right. Yeah.
We had fun.
Because I don't want you coming back after how many years now and saying, like, the Me Too movement, look at what he did.
No.
Now, look who's looking all glammed up tonight is Charlene.
Yeah. Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
My old makeup is coming off.
No, you look great tonight. You look just absolutely stunned tonight.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I have a new wall behind me. So, Alex, you're saying about therapy? I have a phenomenal therapist. I hope you get one like that. He's really funny, and he likes like old movies and stuff like that. And I'm dying to go back to therapy a little bit just so I could be with George, his name is. I always say to him, he's young, and I go, do you know, which way did he go, George?
Here's the thing that gets me. Mm-hmm. What are they going to be able to do for me in 12 weeks?
I know, I've gone through the 12 weeks. You know what happens? Sometimes it gets worse. But if you tell them, like, something hurts more after it, it helps them target something, Alex, like, you know, whatever it is or something. You know?
No, I think I just need to walk more, you know? I mean, and
yeah,
I need...
Yeah, probably.
I wish my feet were number, because it's the bottom of my feet that hurt, you know?
I have numbness right now, Alex. Mm-hmm.
What were you going to say?
Early stages.
Were you going to say something, Deb, Roberta?
I was just going to say, the best thing for you is to walk, which is why you want to sit there and have somebody come in and work on you.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I've been walking, but, you know, it's not easy. It hasn't been easy lately.
Yeah.
Do more of your walks in the park. We love those videos.
Yeah, but I can't walk that far anymore.
Yeah.
You know.
I know New York in parks like that, you know, you got to. You don't want to go and overdo it, and then, you know, it's not fun when you,
right.
You know.
Well, I will go up to that park, and then I'll do one of those shows, because everybody likes those shows.
I know. I miss the fucking turtles.
You got some randy turtles in that park.
People are acting like I'm doing animal porn now. These turtles, and they always hang out on top of each other. I don't know why. Are they having sex, or is that just they're being?
It could be. I think they could be.
Is that sex, or are they just cuddling?
Well, maybe they cuddle too. Yeah.
Yeah.
But that's a beautiful. Doesn't it have fish too, or just the turtles?
What the? It's just the turtles.
The mirrors. That's the mirror.
Well, we have the mirror. We have the mirror, and there are screwing turtles there. And then we go up to this other park, and there are thousands of screwing turtles. So, anyway. So, here, anybody today, did anybody watch the Olympic opening ceremonies today?
They're just coming on out here.
They went on.
They were on earlier. But
they were on earlier.
Nobody watches it early here.
That was live. Marjorie's been waiting for months for this thing. Oh, boy, the opening ceremonies of the Olympics. And she set her clock today, and she had a delivery coming, and she made sure it came before the Olympics because she was going to sit there, and she was going to watch the opening ceremonies. Now, we have watched some great opening ceremonies. The Chinese opening ceremonies were one of the greatest ceremonies of all time. I mean, it were just spectacular, okay? And I went to the one in Barcelona. I went to the opening ceremonies, and it was just wonderful to be there, you know? I was sitting across from where all the dignitaries were sitting, and in there were like... Fidel Castro was there, and all the big world leaders were in that grandstand. If you had bombed that grandstand, you would have wiped out most of the world leaders. So that was a wonderful thing because I was there and I enjoyed it. You know. Well, she comes and starts watching it. She watches these boats floating down the river. And she looks at me and goes, "This sucks." This is the most, and it was really, in a way, the most disorganized way to do it. You know, when you have a stadium, and then you have people dancing and doing this and doing that and trapezes and whatever, you're all sitting there watching it. But now, if you're on the Seine, all you're watching them on are big television screens that are scattered throughout the parade, you know, the boat route. And it just didn't work. You know, and half the stuff they were showing were pre-recorded films and things like that. You know, people dancing around as they're fixing the Notre Dame Cathedral. And it was just, it was ill-conceived. Okay, that's the best way I can put it. Just
that's what I saw when I was watching it a few minutes ago. I looked at it and I went, this is weird. There's a bunch of people floating by on a boat.
Yeah.
Well, they're all used to, you know, the...
spectacular show.
Bike ride. No, they're used to the bike rides through, you know, the Tour de France and the bike rides. You know, you stand in one spot and watch all the bikers go whoosh, 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 by. You know, there you go.
Yeah, but the thing with that is that is also a losing deal, because what you're doing is you're waiting for these bikes to come by, and when they come by, they all come by within like about a 10-minute period, and then that's it. You've missed it unless you can run really fast and go to another place in the route, you know.
Yeah, well, France is conditioned to that. That's what I'm saying.
This thing mirrored the world. It wasn't conditioned to what they did here. I mean, there was something just not, it didn't work, you know.
And they didn't practice at all either.
Wow.
They didn't rehearse anything.
Yeah, they didn't rehearse anything. Why didn't they? Was it because they couldn't?
That and... what do you rehearse when you're on a boat?
Yeah.
Well, no, they weren't on. No, well, who was on the boat? Okay, yeah, you always have the Parade of Nations.
Right.
Okay, which is usually somewhere during the middle of the ceremonies, okay, before the flame burning and the. They do a whole bunch of stuff, and then they do the Parade of Nations. And that takes about an hour and a half, something like that. And everybody walks through, and then they all go to the center of the stadium, and they're standing there, and they're all being looked at by the world. You know, it's a very nice thing. It's a wonderful thing. You wait for your nation to come by. You wait for some nations that you want. Like I wanted to today, and I didn't get to see it. I wanted to see Ukraine, and I don't know how many people, you know, they were putting in there.
Weren't they on the... the refugee team, because there was a refugee team.
There's a refugee team
at war.
Yeah, there's a refugee team. I don't think Gaza had a team.
It's the countries that were at war. Yeah.
Yeah, and so I mean that's wonderful. But in any event, I just didn't feel the wonderful thing you feel with the Olympics, and it's, you know, it's a wonderful thing. I've been to. See, I went to 2 Winter Olympics and to, was it 3 Summer Olympics? I mean, I went to Barcelona. I went to Barcelona and I went to Atlanta. Okay. Barcelona was wonderful. And Lillehammer was wonderful. But, I mean, this thing was just, I don't know, maybe the French didn't want to rehearse, I guess. You know, they're just lazy.
Lazy,
right? Yeah. Had a lot of security issues, I heard too.
Yeah, well, they had the train. There's an arson thing with the train, so people couldn't get into town. So it was not a pretty situation. But I just thought I was so sorry for Marjorie because she was so looking forward to this thing, and she was so utterly disappointed. That about halfway through it, she said, let's go out and have lunch, you know. So we went out and had lunch. And she didn't want to really... Well, then we came back, and they were in the Trocadero, and they were doing a lot of speeches that nobody... People were being bored out of their wits from because they were all doing them in French, and nobody speaks French except the French, okay? And then they did the lighting of the flame. And
Snoop Dogg.
Well, first they had everybody come in with the flame, you know, like they do, and they pass it to somebody else, and then they pass it to somebody else, and then they passed it to, what's his name, Nadal, tennis player, Rafael Nadal. And then he gets in a boat.
There's the boat.
I'm not kidding you. He gets in a boat on the sand, little motorboat, with Serena, and I'm trying to remember a couple other people, well-known people in sports, and they float down the sand. Now, you figure, like, somewhere along the line, there's going to be some place where they're going to light the flame, right? No. They then get off the boat. One person gets off the boat and then hands the torch to somebody else, who then runs through the Tuileries, which is a kind of a garden in France. I can't remember where it is now. I've been in the Tuileries. And it's somewhere near Notre Dame. And they go to the center of the Tuileries, and what's there but this big giant cauldron attached to a balloon? Now, what happened, you know, balloons have hydrogen in them. What do they have in them? Helium.
Helium.
They can have hydrogen.
Yeah. What happens when you
put... Go boom.
Yeah, what happens with with helium when you add fire?
Nothing. It puts out the fire.
Oh, does it put out the fire?
It asphyxiates the fire.
Oh, does it really? I didn't know that. But anyway, then they take this balloon and they float it up. And it's a really ugly, it's like a cauldron on fire, not just an Olympic flame. It's the Olympic barbecue. You know,
they use flames in balloons, you know.
You're right. You're right.
In order to keep the heat up into...
Maybe that's the thing that's keeping the balloon going up. I don't know. But anyway, so this balloon's going to be floating up there for 2 weeks, I guess. And then I guess they yank it down and get out fire extinguishers or something.
No. You cannot put out the Olympic flame. Sorry.
No, you put out the at the end of the Olympics, you put out the flame.
But they light a torch to carry it to the next Olympics.
Yeah, they maintain
ceremoniously
all that flame in order to continue it. Yeah.
Hasn't it gone out by accident? What? I think I remember hearing about that, and they had to relight it. They don't like when that happens, right?
Well, no, they constantly are going out. In fact, they were carrying them tonight in the rain, okay?
Well, yeah.
Right? And they kept going out, and it's not like somebody came back with a Bic lighter and relit it. There was something in it that kept it, you know, relit it immediately. Yeah. So it would go out, they would relight immediately, they would go out some more, and they would relight immediately. So it wasn't, you know... And it isn't
the thermal igniter is what it is.
Yeah.
Is that what it is?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like your pilot on your water heater or whatever.
Yeah.
So, you know, it doesn't matter if it went out. It just went right back on again, you know. So it was a strange little.
It depends on what the fuel is, too. If the fuel is hydrogen, and they can use hydrogen if they use it the right way, you can't see the flame either. So the hydrogen flame is practically invisible.
Yeah.
And everybody
was
wondering.
That's how we trained when we were filling hydrogen at our plant.
Yeah.
If we had a leak, our first emergency response was to walk with a whisk broom in front of us. We had a wick broom, not the regular broom, but a, you know, old whisk broom. And we put that in front of us in case there was a leak and you couldn't see the flame, it would catch fire.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh. Hey, there's somebody who wants to get on right now named Coco Nano. I wouldn't trust that. Should I?
No, I don't know. That sounds a little suspicious.
I thought she was holding a flag tonight in Paris.
Yeah, Coco Nano.
Some French stripper or something. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Coco, go away. Yeah. Well, I mean, I could try it. I could put on my picture here. See, what happens is some of these people who try to get on, they get on. And then we wait, and then all of a sudden there's a horrible picture of some guy doing something horrible.
Yeah.
You know, It isn't even good porn, you know. It's it's, how can I describe it? It's fecal porn.
Yeah.
Nasty.
Huh?
It's nasty.
Yeah, it is. It is. So,
I had to be gatekeeper for our. Again, I was the trainer for a couple of the political campaigns, and the way that you do phone banking is that you have people from all over the country come in on a Zoom call. So you have to monitor and see who's, you know, in the waiting room and see if you want to accept them. And I had to screen out quite a few people. It's amazing.
Well, it's very difficult to do because Zoom hasn't really put the process in there where you can, like, as soon as you see somebody who's done something bad, you can, like, you know, completely keep them from ever being able to get in again. Right, blocking them.
There is a setting. You as administrator can do that. You can either set it so that they're just blocked for the period for that particular session, or you can block them permanently. You'll have to go into the admin settings.
Because
what
I would want
to change their name.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, they'd have to. I think it's also tied to IP address. Also, I'm thinking. I don't remember now.
Yeah,
could
yeah.
be. Yeah.
I didn't have to block them that much because what we did was we just ignored them and just dumped them if we saw them again. It was real easy.
Well, I will say this to Coco: if you are legitimate and you're okay, and you want me to put you on, you just simply go to. I'm trying to figure where I am here. You simply go to our Facebook page. Where does it come up? Our YouTube page someplace. Yeah, okay, yeah.
YouTube link.
Go to our YouTube.
Yeah, YouTube.
Go to our YouTube page, which is, where is it?
Put something in the chat.
It's in the comments. It's in the comments.
No, but I'm looking for my YouTube page.
I got it up if you want to borrow it.
No, wait a minute. Oh, there it is. There it is. Okay. I just found it. Okay. So Coco, just put something on our chat, okay, on YouTube, and we'll, you know, we can let you through. Of course, you know, who knows what.
We'll vet you.
What?
We'll vet him.
We'll vet you.
We'll vet them.
Right.
Alex?
Yes.
Were you going to mention that Lady Gaga performed and Celine Dion?
Oh, yeah. Lady Gaga performed. She was okay. Mm-hmm. She wasn't great. She isn't as good as I've heard her in the past. But then again, she had to sing in French, you know. Mm-hmm. And then Celine Dion, who has supposedly been not performed since 2000, who's had a real terrible problem where her body doesn't work or something. I don't know what it is.
Yeah, I can't remember what they call what she has.
It's a muscle issue, yeah.
Yeah, it's a muscle issue. She got up and sang tonight. She was spectacular.
Yeah, my aunt told me she didn't find anything wrong with her voice at all, that she thought it was great.
She was spectacular, and I've never been a big fan of Celine Dion. And I don't know why, because she's not bad. She's not bad at all.
She's okay.
But no, she's good. I've heard her do some. I heard her do. There's a thing on YouTube of her doing River Deep Mountain High
with Paul Schaefer.
And she was spectacular, you know. Mm-hmm. So she is good. And I think I just didn't want to like her because, you know, the Titanic thing, you know, I can't.
Yeah. We got sick of that song because it was all over.
I got sick of that song about 5 minutes
feel like
into
you're
the
in an
picture.
Elevator.
What?
Yeah.
Feel like you're in an elevator.
Yeah. You do feel like you're in an elevator. Let's see here. It says Bree entered waiting room. Let's see if it is Bree. Okay. It may not be Bree. We don't know.
An imposter.
In fact, let me just put my face on here, so that Bree, are you? Are we just. We it says he's joining. But he's having trouble joining. Is it Bree? Is it going to be Bree? I'll tell you here in a second. Bree. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. It is Bree. It is genuinely It is genuinely Bree. Hello, Bree. How are you?
Hello. I'm good, thank you. I just had too many gadgets. I think I was using a new one that can't handle the load, so I'm on my back on my own. Hope it's okay.
You've got some weird little sound in your sound, little thing in your sound.
I think he has another audio source on at the same time.
No, I don't think so. Oh. Maybe he does.
Well, they're playing music in the background. Could that be it? No, all my other Bluetooths are off.
Hmm. Okay.
It's something to do with your microphone.
Yeah.
Every time you talk.
Yeah, maybe you could sign off and come back in again. It might clear itself up. So do that. Okay. Yeah. Plus he's
Alex?
Calling. Yes.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. No. Go ahead.
Oh well, I wanted to say welcome to Roberta. Can we ask her like what state is she in? Because I don't think we found that out yet, right? Where is she?
Chicago, Illinois.
Chicago.
Oh, Chicago.
Yeah. And her job sounds interesting. Like, you know, can she give us a little thing, you know, tell us a little bit about that again?
Well, what you did to Zoom? It sounds like you're doing an application for somebody to be on this show.
Sorry, I'm not an interviewer, but
no, that's
I think it sounds interesting. I'd like to do something like that. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Okay. Yeah. Well, my background was in radio and consumer behavior, and because of all the consumer behavior stuff, I started doing things for political campaigns. They had me come in and do, the phone banking, and I was the main trainer for the Mary Peltola campaign and for the Dean Phillips campaign in New Hampshire. And what I was able to do is look at what the voting public was saying to us, what they liked, what they didn't like, what were the triggers, what were the hot triggers, what were the negatives, whatever, and get and train our phone bankers to be able to communicate with the voters in order to convince them, you know, that these were the right candidates. And we got to learn an awful lot. Something really cool that happened in New Hampshire. Some people talked about it, but it wasn't big news, but they were all very open about it. In New Hampshire, you don't have to claim a party when they run the primary. You can pick and choose which party you want to vote with,
right,
for the primary. You can cross over, right.
Yeah.
And then after the primary is done, you can then cross back again if you want. So what we were getting from the Democratic voters is we had can I cuss on here? Mm-hmm. We had a shit ton of people that were saying, okay, I am going to vote for Nikki Haley, anybody to keep Trump off. And there was this huge group of people doing Nikki Haley. And the problem was we wanted them to be voting for Dean Phillips. And so we're like, hey, you're wasting your vote. Were, because they weren't going to be voting for, you know, a Republican. It was one of those things where we just had to talk them into not voting for Nikki Haley, but it was a huge thing. I mean, she got a large number of votes, and those were mostly, no, I shouldn't say mostly, they were significantly from the Democrats who crossed over to vote for her. They were very open. I mean, we thought it was like a secret, but they were totally open about, hey, I'm sorry, I'm going to vote Republican. We're like, are you Republican? No, I'm a Democrat. I'm all in for Democrat, but I'm going to go over and I'm going to vote for Nikki Haley just to keep Trump out of the White House. So it was really fascinating.
You did that by way of phone bank, not at the polls, though.
No, not at the polls.
Because that's electioneering. I work at the polls here in California, and electioneering. Yeah.
No, I wasn't in.
Because we had the same thing.
I couldn't be at the polls. I was sitting right here in Chicago.
You can't.
We had the same thing. We had the same trends here when I worked at the poll. I run a polling center here in the West Coast.
Okay.
And it was pretty insane with people wanting to switch votes. This last primary, it was constant. I want to switch. Oh, I can do that. And it was crazy because we are constantly re-registering people.
Yeah.
And yeah, I think the primaries are a pain in the butt.
I think they're useless.
They are.
And
they can be useful, but I think they're just, because they put so many caveats in there, they've gotten useless. They're kind of diluted.
You've heard my take on it is that primaries didn't exist until 1912. But then there were just a couple of states that did it. And it wasn't until the 60s that we had full-on primaries. And it has changed the whole thing to where we're having people run for office 2 years before the presidential campaign.
Yeah, it's crazy.
You know, the way it used to happen when I was a kid, when I was a young lad, that was back in the 1800s, you would have a convention.
Chunk of stone and a chisel.
You would have a convention, okay? You would have a convention, and then people would then go out and run for office. And it was about a 3-month period between the end of the conventions and the beginning of the season for them to go out and make their case. Well, all of a sudden, they're doing it a year and a half out. And it's useless. It's absolutely useless. Plus, primaries cost the states money. Why should they have to put out that money? Hey, go to your convention, argue among yourselves, get your standard bearer, say who they are, come out of the convention, and then the two parties or the three parties or the four parties can fight it out with each other. And then it's a small window. I mean, I think the advantage right now that Kamala Harris has is that she only has 3 months to really fight this thing. That's fine. That's terrific. She will make her case. She's got a good wind going for her now. And that's going to continue because it's pretty much a do or die. It's not so long that a year from now she's going to run out of steam. Okay?
Right.
So anyway, that's my case, and I'm sticking it to it.
Well, the problem with not having primaries or with having them decide among themselves is that right now we have a situation where there's only two parties, basically, and they make it almost impossible for any other parties to come through. And that's what would probably solve something like that is what they have done in Alaska and a few other states is, you know, having the ranked choice voting. And that puts, you know, absolute fear into a lot of the, you know, the parties and other people.
Well, what you vote for is who you want, number one, number two, number three, number four, whatever.
That's correct. Yeah. And it runs really well. What happens is they start after the first round, they go for the bottom and they chop the bottom person off and take that person's, all the people that voted for number four, you know, five, whoever is on the bottom of the list, however you do your ranked choice voting, they take their second choice people and then assign those to the other candidates. That way, if you're like, you know, anybody but Trump, so, okay, I don't really want to vote for, you know, Kamala, but maybe I'm going to vote for, you know, somebody else. So now I will vote for somebody else. And if that somebody else, you know, like, you know, Cornel West or somebody like that drops out, or isn't valid, then your vote goes to Kamala because that was your second choice. And it's very fair in my opinion.
Well, it's certainly easier, but I still think the whole primary system sucks, you know?
Yeah. Well, people are anointed anyway. I mean, look what happened to Bernie Sanders. I mean, it didn't matter. They didn't want him. They were going to figure out how to get rid of him.
You know, I think Bernie Sanders is more valuable right where he is. You know, I mean, he's the good naysayer, as it were. Of course, Charlie would disagree with me, Charlie, right? You were all for
it. Why? I was Bernie Sanders in 2016 and 2020.
Yeah, yeah.
I campaigned for Bernie, so I'm in.
Well, here's what I love.
I campaigned for Bernie. I campaigned for Nina Turner. I drove over to Ohio a couple of times and did some Nina Turner canvassing.
Ohio. Yeah.
Well, I was close to that. I went out and campaigned for Tina Turner. So
I've worked on many political campaigns.
You've what?
I've worked on many political campaigns. It's what I wanted to do when I was in college. I wanted to be a diplomat. So I was going to reunite the Germans, but that happened while I was in school, so I had to do other things. I've worked for Democrats, I've worked for Republicans, and my favorite was to work for Greens. The Greens are more passionate, and they have a lot of potlucks and covered dish dinners. Of course, if you work for the Republicans, you get to expense your food. And Democrats, you're usually just eating fast food.
The Greens have good potluck dinners?
Oh, yeah.
Really? How did I miss that one?
Yeah.
Well, at least in New York, where I was working,
yeah,
we had some great get-togethers. It was a wonderful community, and I was sad that, you know, we couldn't win, but it was always an uphill battle. But I think in some cases they, you know, they influenced the others, usually the Democrats. But
You still got that funny sound, but we can understand you, so that's all that matters.
It's funny. These are the most expensive and top-of-the-line Sony XM5s, so I don't know why they have a problem with Sony.
That's because the top-of-the-line, they know they got you, you know. Anyway, so, you know, I mean, the big flop sweat now is Trump is getting flop sweat. He's really going crazy. He's being just stupid. Statement that I heard, and I'm sure Roberta will agree with me on this, he keeps saying that Kamala is a real lefty. She's really far to the left. And he keeps pushing that. And I'm thinking, well, I'm far to the left, and I only wish that she was, but she isn't. Yeah. Am I right?
I wish you were far to the left.
You're not far enough to the left for some of us.
Yeah.
No, I think she's centrist. She's almost centrist.
She's centrist, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
But no, she's going to be the downfall of America because she's almost a commie, you know.
Well, they say the same about Trump, that it's all the he's neo-Nazis.
Well, how are you handicapping this thing now, Bree? Kamala.
Well, the big problem was she released this ad that uses Beyonce's Freedom. And that, to me, was a red flag, because I recall Taylor Swift pushing very hard in Tennessee for the Democrat candidate against Marsha Blackburn, and Blackburn won. Taylor Swift had no effect. A lot of times when you go with the media and go with the celebrities, it seems like it's an overwhelming advantage, but at the voting booth, it may not be. And the other thing that concerns me is they always say she's going towards the younger groups. Younger groups never vote. You can't look. Every Democrat who has relied on new people voting has usually failed. So these are a little bit of sticking points for me, but she's got all the media right now. And that's why Trump is sad, because he loves to have all the media.
Yeah,
well, she's got it.
Yeah, she's got it, and is driving him nuts, you know.
Yeah.
And he doesn't know how to fight this. He really doesn't.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, right.
It
took a lot of the wind out of his sail. Boy, he had wind. And that was...
Yeah, I mean, it's down to the point where nobody mentions him in the news. You know, they just show him making stupid statements, and that's it.
Yeah.
Actually,
he's crying because he isn't in the news.
Well, he isn't getting as much publicity as J.D. Vance.
Yep.
You know.
Yeah.
You know, with his,
the media wants something new.
Yep, and I think she also has brought a certain positivity to the whole thing. You know, it's nice when somebody gets up there before they give a speech and they're smiling. You know, we haven't had that in quite a while in American politics.
Yeah.
You know, and she's not smiling for any supercilious reason. She's just delighted to be up there, you know, and delighted to make her case. And I think she's, and I don't think you'll disagree with me on this, Bree, she's hitting all the right notes.
She is. She definitely is. You can tell that the power brokers are sitting around with her. When she gave her first speech, she hit all the points that were in her ad. So she's on message. She's on target. He's got a quick wit, and boy, and she made some really, really sharp jabs at Trump that were also funny. And it reminded me that politics could be fun in a way that's not and not mean-spirited. I think she does it in a fun way.
Well, I also think the reason he doesn't want to debate her is because he doesn't want to debate her is because she is, you know, she's in prosecutorial form right now more than anything else.
Well, and she knows exactly what Trump's going to say in a debate. He's so predictive. He's just going to go through his normal spiel, and she can attack him. When you look at the debate with Biden, it's like, you know, if Biden could go double speed than how slow he was going, he could have done something. But with her, she's just going to he's going to be tossing up softballs, and she's going to be racking them.
Well, she's a prosecutor and more than that, a lawyer. And pretty good at making a legal case. And if she goes into a debate with Trump, I'm sorry, he can't win.
What's been on for so long.
What?
Yeah. And he won't have to get nasty about it. She will place everything just perfectly, you know.
Well, you remember that I remember a key moment in her career when she was running for president before. And she went up in a debate with Biden, and she nailed him to the wall.
Yeah.
She just nailed him. She walked away from that, and people were saying, maybe she should be the nominee. You know?
Yeah, that was her one moment.
Yeah, that was her one moment. Well, she's going to have a lot of them now.
Yeah.
You know? And she's so itching to debate Trump, and Trump says, oh, of course I'll debate you. But he's giving every reason why he can't.
Yeah.
You know, oh, the dog ate my homework. I'm sorry.
He can't hear out of one ear, so he can't hear.
Well, that's the other thing. Here's the other story that's getting to me. It seems as though the FBI wants to talk to him.
Yes.
They want to talk to him not about anything wrong. They just want to interview him about his ear.
Yeah.
Because somehow there was never any reporting by doctors about what was wrong with his ear, right? And it turns out there's a good chance, and I said this on the show, and then somebody said, oh, no, it was another way, and so I just gave in to you. But now what the FBI wants to find out from him is some information because they think it was a piece of shrapnel. Perhaps
that came back up in the last couple of days.
Yeah. I've been saying
that.
I was right on that. They're saying that the shrapnel from the teleprompter hit his ear and cut his ear a little bit. So when he saw he was bleeding, he just played it up for everything he possibly could. But really,
he took a bullet for democracy.
He's got a little bandage on it right now. I mean, if it took a nick out of his ear, he'd still be on antibiotics and everything. But no, you know.
They didn't give him stitches. The one time a doctor spoke up, they said they didn't give him stitches.
But wouldn't you give him stitches if he had been shot in the ear?
I would think so.
That's cartilage.
Yeah, but what's the
You know.
You know how many...
What?
There's going to be a picture when he finally takes that Band-Aid off, you know, of it zoomed in and, oh, my God.
The cat bit of
him. Oh, no, he's going to keep he's going to keep the bandage. He's going to keep that bandage on until Election Day.
Yep.
He doesn't want anybody to see that there's.
I heard he took it off.
No, he took he took the air tampon off.
Yeah, I know that, but I heard he took the bandage off, too, and said he wasn't going to wear it anymore. But there's so much crap going around about the damn thing. It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But God saved his life, don't you know?
God saved his life. He took he's a hero. He took a bullet for democracy. He's just, we all should bow to
him. Well, Donald, hasn't it occurred to you that maybe God was trying to get you and he was just a bad aim?
Yeah, he just missed. Ask Tony.
But does his story get any more funny? I mean, it's just hilarious.
Yeah. Well, I mean, at least now, you know, I had a real problem with Biden because of his.
Yeah.
You know, we felt it hurt us to watch him. Okay.
Yeah.
And even in his speech that he gave the other night, he wasn't that with it. All right. And that's fine. Go out. Go quit. You know, it's time to finish. Finish up. clean out your desk. You know, carry your boxes out the front door. Whatever.
Certain boxes.
Yeah, certain boxes. Yeah. Not all of them. And spend the rest of your life enjoying it. You know, you've done a good job for America. You enjoy. You need to retire. It's time to retire. Mm-hmm. And.
I love watching Obama having fun.
What do you mean?
Oh, yeah.
How's he having fun?
Well, he's always off vacationing in Hawaii.
Oh, yeah. Oh, of course. Yeah. Of course.
Yeah.
Listen, when he was through being president, he didn't want to do that anymore.
Yeah.
Come on.
And I remember they kept saying, oh, Michelle will run. Michelle will run. They're like, no.
Michelle doesn't want to be president.
Yeah, I know.
You said, hell no.
Hell no.
8 years
this house had enough of that stuff.
You know, but they did the presidency. They were happy doing that. Now they're on with the rest of their life, and they're doing all the things they want to do, and they're living a happy life. You know.
That's what Melania wants to do.
But on the other hand, did you see Melania at the convention?
That's what I just said.
Boy, that was a woman who didn't want to be there.
Oh, right? Yeah. There was a shot of her, and he did something. He, like, turned away and, like, rolled her eyes.
No, she came over. She came on stage. She was going to be the good Melania. She didn't want to give a speech this time. But she was going to be the good Melania, come on stage and say how good it was, you know, and everything like that. And he went in for the kiss, and she gave him the cheek. You know, and the only other time she was really great that night was when Kid Rock was on, was it? Was it Kid Rock? Is that who it was?
Yeah.
Yeah. Singing. And she was looking like, you know, I mean, she was not
happy.
Maybe
that was one of her old stripper songs or something that he was playing. You know, they always had those Motley Crue songs, you know, in Kid Rock when the strippers came out in Vegas, you know?
Well, you know, you have to get the rights to play that music at the convention. Cool. Because for a while there, Trump was just pulling, you know, music out his ass. He was using, like, the Eagles and so on. And they said, will you stop using us, please?
Yeah.
We don't want you to use our music, and you haven't licensed it. So all he's got is Kid Rock and Hulk Hogan humming, okay?
Ted Nugent,
I mean, well, whoever told them that Hulk Hogan was a good idea?
God, that was funny.
He did.
Yeah.
He did? You mean Trump?
He told himself.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right.
Because that's showmanship.
Yeah.
And that's what Trump is, showmanship. And that's what the UFC guy was there for.
He means
he came off his vacation. His wife told him, you go.
What were you saying, Bree?
He needs those people to vote. He needs young males to go to the polls for him. That's right. And they don't. They just don't care. I think it's like the lowest turnout is among young male voters. They just can't be bothered.
Roberta sent me a message. Hi, Roberta. What does it say?
It was a personal message. Never mind.
A personal message. Oh, okay.
I missed that.
Well, you can send me those at alex@gabnet.net. You know. I would be happy to return the message.
She said you have a booger coming out of your nose.
I'm eating here, please. I'm eating. Come on.
Mighty, yeah. Anyway, so
thanks
so
a lot.
You know, I think we've got in Trump, we've got somebody who is not exactly feeling comfortable right now. You know, because a couple of days ago he felt we got the election in the bag, but he kept going after Biden, and eventually when Biden quit. It was his worst nightmare. He
got millions of dollars invested in these. Let's go. What did he call?
There was a certain.
Let's go, Brandon.
Let's go, Brandon.
Oh yeah, that's right.
And they're useless now.
I'll buy one.
Oh, that's hysterical. I didn't think about
that. Oh, no, the Republican Party has said they're going to file suit against the Democratic Party for screwing up their game plan.
Yeah. They're not even supposed to have anybody until their convention, right? I know you guys are talking about primaries, but, you know, they're not supposed to have anybody until their convention anyways. You know, that's how usually, you know, back when Alex was a kid went, you know, and they announced it then, you know. And
well, no, what's going to happen is they're going to do a virtual of all the delegates ahead of time, and so she will be the nominee before they go into the convention.
Yeah,
but it's not official until the convention and the delegate. Whenever they vote, whether they're super delegates, regular delegates, it doesn't matter. The point is, it's not supposed to be official until that convention, so they can't complain.
Right. She is being required by the Democratic Party by August 7th to come up with a vice presidential selection.
Yeah, I heard that today. Yeah.
And I'm suggesting J.D. Vance because he really should have.
I agree.
Yeah. Because I don't know if he's going to be the nominee for the Republican Party much longer. I mean, can they do that? Can they suddenly take him out now? I don't know. I wish.
Yes, sir.
Huh?
I don't know.
They can,
but it's pretty unlikely.
They can do anything,
but it's unlikely. Yeah.
These people are not feeling good about. About J.D.
No, he's like a young Trump that just keeps stepping on his weenie.
Yeah.
He is so bad. He's not as funny as Trump. He is so bad, it's even bothering Trump. Okay?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Which is awesome.
Oh, it's wonderful. It's just wonderful.
Yeah, I love it.
You know? It's amazing to me all the way
Maybe
around.
Trump will put a hit on him or something.
Yeah.
That doesn't go on.
I sent that up for everybody. That's the Walls. The governor of Minnesota, Walls, is one of the potential runners. And he, on the last link I sent, he's making big media news, social media news. And UAW seems to like him, and he seems like a pretty good guy.
Well, I happen to like Kelly. I think he's a good choice, but I think, quite frankly, Pete Buttigieg, you know, is very good. And
I think it will be Shapiro.
Are you going to think it's going to be Shapiro? Okay, you know, I don't know. I don't know if it should be Shapiro or not. You know, I. There are people that are doing really good where they are, and we don't want to get rid of them, you know? Yeah. And he's doing very good in Pennsylvania, and he's holding on to that state for the Democrats. And, you know.
That's my state.
What? What were you saying?
I'm from Pennsylvania.
Oh. So you like Shapiro? Yeah. According to Marjorie, however, in Philadelphia, it's pronounced Shapiro.
Go Bird!
Yeah.
Go Bucks.
Anyway, boy, this has been a nice night tonight. I really have appreciated this. And Roberta, it's great that you've been calling us because we've really added nicely to this program.
We had two chicks on the show tonight. That's awesome.
Two chicks?
Yeah.
What century are you from? You mean two broads?
Oh, I got.
Oh, here comes another broad.
Two and a half.
Hi.
Huh? Hey, good night. She's becoming more sedate. Uh-oh. Well, maybe not. That's Adrian. That's okay. Thank you, Charlie. We appreciate you being here. And, of course, Roberta, please call us again. Call next week. We like you being on here. Charlene Martinez. I don't know what happened to Charlene. I think she passed out the way that...
I think she passed out.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. Big thank you to Kevin. And, big goodbye to Brian Neri and his lovely wife, Adrian.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Bree, for calling all the way from Malaysia. I know that the phone call is very expensive. Anyway, thank you all, and give a big big wave goodbye, and I'll give a big wave goodbye at you, okay? There they go, ladies and gentlemen. That's our panel for tonight. We'll do another one of these things on Monday with the pop-up show, which goes out over Facebook at 4 o'clock on Monday. And then we'll be back here again next Wednesday at 10:30 Eastern Time. Same time, same station in life. And in the meantime, as always, if you see her, tell her I love her, okay? Good night, everybody, and have a nice weekend.